There are few features more captivating and enigmatic than the triconsonantal or triliteral root system. In the Semitic languages, like Hebrew, Arabic, and Syriac, a root isn't a concrete, pronounceable form, it's just a string of three consonants associated with a particular semantic domain. To make a functional word, these three consonants are slotted into one of a number of vowel templates, which, in conjunction with a handful of more typical prefixes and suffixes, form the basis of verb conjugations, nominal plurals, and derivational strategies. When you first come across it, it just seems so novel and so different from the way that almost any other language is structured that, naturally, there's a temptation to include this kind of system in a conlang. And to do that, all you have to do is make all your roots in the form of three consonants, and then make up some vowel patterns and ascribe meanings to them. Now that's totally fine if naturalism isn't a priority to you, or if you're going for something more surface level and don't really care about the details, but if you're aiming for maximal naturalism, that's not really how these things work. The vast majority of languages have morphology that works in terms of concatenation, attaching prefixes and suffixes to stems to modify their meanings. But occasionally in natural languages, we find morphology that appears inside a stem. The triconsonantal root system represents an extreme form of this non-concatenative morphology. So to make a naturalistic triconsonantal root system, we need to understand where this non-concatenative morphology comes from. Let's make a quick test language for illustrative purposes. We'll give it a pretty simple phonetic inventory, a CVC syllable structure, and stress that always falls on the second to last syllable. One of the most common forms of non-concatenative morphology is vowel alternation, in which grammatical meanings are encoded by changes in the vowel of the stem. And one of the easiest ways to make this happen is with umlaut, sometimes called I mutation, in which a high front vowel can trigger assimilation of the preceding vowel. In particular, the vowel E is pronounced with the tongue far forward and raised to the palate, and in preparation for this maneuver, the vowel of the previous syllable might get pronounced closer to where the E is pronounced, so the tongue doesn't have to move as far. This has the effect of fronting and/or raising the vowel that comes before the E, with the exact change in quality depending on the language's phonology. So perhaps in our test language, there's a suffix of the form E, which replaces the final vowel of the stem. Then we'll implement umlaut, which for simplicity we'll say turns any preceding vowel into another E. Then, if word final vowels are lost, now we have a grammatical inflection that was once indicated by a suffix, but is now signified by a change in vowel quality. Although most common with E, a final A may also cause fronting of the preceding vowel, and though a bit rarer, an R vowel might drag previous sounds down and further back. So if we have a suffix with a prominent long R vowel, it may turn the previous vowel into an R. But word internal changes can be a lot more substantial than just vowel alternation. Sometimes extra consonants or even entire syllables can wind up embedded inside a stem. These are called infixes, and they're much, much rarer than prefixes and suffixes. If we want to create some infixes, there's really only one thing for it: metathesis, a sound change wherein two sounds in a word trade places. Metathesis isn't particularly common, and it's often quite unpredictable, but one motivation for it is, much like with umlaut, the anticipation of an upcoming sound. In American English, some speakers pronounce the word cavalry as calvary, which happens when the tongue is moved into position for the L before pronouncing the V, and then the L just sort of bleeds over. In our test language, we could use this same trick to get some infixes. If we have some auxiliaries that get suffixed onto the lexical verb, then say that a sequence consisting of any consonant followed by L or R will cause the sounds to switch places, now we've managed to get these consonants inside our stems. And while we're at it, coda liquids also very frequently cause wacky effects on the vowels that precede them. Quite often, languages will make fewer vowel distinctions before a rhotic or R-like sound than elsewhere. Not only that, but coda R can sometimes just disappear entirely, leaving a long vowel in its wake, much like in my dialect of English. We can also do this in our test language, having any vowel occurring in a syllable with a coda R becoming R, and then the R is lost and the R undergoes compensatory lengthening. Meanwhile, coda L can be quite volatile. Sometimes it turns into a Y, and sometimes it becomes W, thereby turning the vowel in the nucleus into a diphthong, which, in turn, might get simplified to a monophthong over time. If our coda L turns into a Y, then all the resultant diphthongs may eventually become reduced to a long E. Now, what started out as infixation born of metathesis has become another form of vowel alternation. Metathesis may also occur to make sounds easier to hear. If we have a prefix ka, and then we say that vowels are lost in unstressed syllables, we might end up with some rather infelicitous clusters, like a word initial ksa. In this environment, the K is a little bit difficult to enunciate and to hear clearly. One way of fixing this is to say that all word initial sequences of a stop followed by a fricative are metathesized. Now, in addition to making the form easier to pronounce, we've got ourselves an infix. You may notice that the steps we're taking to implement infixation rely on certain phonetic conditions being met, unlike most prefixes and suffixes. It's partly for this reason that infixes are so rare in comparison to other kinds of morphology. However, some languages, like Tagalog and many of the other Austronesian languages, are replete with infixes to a seemingly inexplicable degree. The secret to this abundance of non-concatenative morphology lies in these languages' syllable structures. Namely, they all forbid consonant clusters. So when a consonant final word becomes prefixed onto a consonant initial word, an illegal cluster is formed. And it looks like the way these were dealt with is by metathesizing the entire prefix with the initial consonant, the result being a plethora of infixes. Although after vowel loss and unstressed syllables, our test language seems pretty content with consonant clusters, maybe it later decides to disallow word initial and word final clusters. One way to deal with these is with a penthesis, the adding of a sound to prevent an otherwise illegal sequence. In our case, we'll insert a short oo to break up any illegal clusters. Now, by this point, you may be wondering to yourself, when are we actually going to make a triconsonantal root system? Well, let's zoom out and have a look at what we've done so far. If we take an example verb and conjugate it for the forms we've made, what we end up with is a system of entirely non-concatenative morphology, and, in fact, from a synchronic perspective, we could very well analyze this as if the root is SPT, and that this root fits into one of these predetermined vowel templates to form grammatical meanings. Voila! We've got ourselves a triconsonantal root system. Now, this is just a fairly simple example and nowhere near as prolific as the systems in the Semitic languages, but it should hopefully give you an idea of how these systems can come about. However, if we conjugate some more verbs, we'll see the patterns we've made don't exactly work 100%. This incongruence is partially to be expected. All natural languages display some degree of irregularity, especially those with systems like this. In Arabic, even something as simple as pluralization has dozens of different patterns, so it's no surprise that the system might be a little haphazard when it first evolves. But the human mind has a very strong tendency to make order out of chaos, and in the case of language, this manifests as analogy. In linguistics, analogy is, in a way, the opposite of irregularity. Instead of creating exceptions to a rule, analogy spreads the rule to areas where it wasn't previously applied. A frequent result of this is the reanalysis and subsequent loss of old irregular forms. Once the triconsonantal root system has been firmly established and the speakers are accustomed to these patterns, analogy can go a long way to standardize the system by ironing out some of the inconsistencies. One pretty obvious thing that will need to be taken care of is the fact that this system only works with roots that have exactly three consonants. If the triconsonantal root system is perceived as the regular pattern, then the speakers may go out of their way to make sure words can fit into it. One way this might be done is through appending words with extra morphology. In English, we have the verb trap, to which we can add the prefix n to make a word that means, well, pretty much exactly the same thing. A similar process could be used to add an extra consonant to any two consonant stems to make them fit with the triconsonantal system. And if this affix begins with a fricative, then the K infix will apply, and if this strategy is used for all old two-syllable roots, then the infix will be quite common, so much so that words that don't use the infix may be considered irregular, and over time, the speakers may get so used to the K infix signifying normalization that they reanalyze the irregular forms as having a K infix as well, while the quote-unquote correct prefixed forms fall out of use. Likewise, a verb root with an R as the final consonant won't fit the pattern for the future tense, but even so, it may be so ingrained in the mind of the speakers that a long E between the second and third consonants encodes the future, that they'll apply the vowel alternation to words in which it never previously occurred. There will always be at least some irregularity, especially in more common words, but with analogy, we can clear up a lot of the clutter of all these competing patterns and establish our non-concatenative system as the dominant, regular marking scheme. So, in summary, to make a naturalistic triconsonantal root system, or indeed any non-concatenative system, use the phonology of prefixes and suffixes to influence changes within the stem. Then, minimize the prominence of the prefixes and suffixes as much as possible, so that the grammatical information is conveyed by the stem change. Then employ analogy to spread the regular paradigm to words whose phonology made them resistant to the sound changes that produced the pattern. For further reading on the evolution of the Semitic triconsonantal systems, as well as a bunch of other stuff, I highly recommend the book The Unfolding of Language by Guy Deutschter, while for more on infixing, check out A Natural History of Infixation by Alan C. Yu. And if you're looking to learn more about analogy, then, as luck would have it, I've been asked to lend some assistance regarding this exact topic. So join me over on the World Building Notes channel to see how Eva and I can incorporate some analogy into her conlang.